Welcome back to our course on Excel 2013 Advanced. In the previous couple of sections we've been looking at pivot tables in Excel 2013, and in this section we're going to continue looking at pivot tables. We're going to concentrate in this section on filtering a pivot table and on the use of slicers. Before we do that, I'd like to do a couple of things that I mentioned earlier on, and one of them is I'd like to change the range of data that's actually covered by the pivot table we've been working on. So this is very straightforward to do, particularly as we set this pivot table up on the basis of using our store sales table. The store sales table we set up with the first 20,000 rows of the data that I had. The data I have extends to 34,109 rows. Let's go back to the pivot table. This is the bottom right hand corner, and the total value of the sales there, $399,000, so we'll call it $400,000. Let's go back into the store data here, click somewhere within the table, and then the Table Tools Design tab, go to Resize Table, and there's the old definition of a range going up to 20,000. Let's make it 34109. Click on OK. Now let's go back to the pivot table. Notice that we still have a value here of 399783.01, so the update is not automatic. Now this is pretty straightforward. If you went to the Analyze tab, you've got a couple of options there in the data group. One of the options is to change the data source altogether. So if in fact you were going to pick up a new set of store data, perhaps the latest figures from another worksheet or even another workbook, you could do that here. But if all you want to do is to refresh the data source you've already got set up, and just bear in mind, if I click on Change Data Source, don't forget the data source here is the table store sales, which I have just changed the definition of. So my pivot table is already defined in terms of a table, a named table. If I go back then into Analyze and just click on Refresh, it does the refresh, and then let me just go along to that total, and you'll see the total now is $804,000. So I've almost doubled not only the number of transactions but the total value as well. Now I just want to adjust what we see a little bit more. So on the Analyze tab in the pivot table tools, Show on the right gives me field list. If I click on that, I can hide the pivot table fields panel. I also use that drop down there to bring it back again. And I'm also going to use the Design tab, Pivot Table Styles. Click on the gallery here and choose a different style from the gallery. I'm going to choose that style there. Okay, now let's start looking at filtering. Now let's start by filtering the rows. So we're talking about which rows are included. To include a row, or not include it for that matter, we've actually got two fields. We have the branch, and then we have the date. Let's start with branches. At the top of the branch column here, basically the branches are shown in column A, we have a drop down, and that leads us to a filter for branches. By default, all branches are selected, but if I click on select all here to deselect all branches, I could for instance say I only want to see Boston. Click on OK, and my pivot table now is reduced to one that only shows Boston. So you won't be surprised to learn that those filters work in pretty much the same way that filters work generally in Excel. So let's go back into that filter again. Let's switch the whole lot back on again, click on OK. So I've now got all of my branches again, and I could similarly go in there and say, right, I'm going to keep all of the branches, but I'm going to choose to sort Z to A. So I'm going to put them in reverse alphabetical order now. And I've also got, of course, the labeled filters, more sophisticated filters, value filters that I can build up in all of the usual ways. So same sort of thing, let's just show the values for July. So click on the date filter here, deselect, and just choose July, click on OK, and the only figures we've got now are July, and we've got the July figures for all of the branches. But of course, although we've got the July figures for all of the branches, Excel only includes columns for the departments where there are sales in July. So the number of columns now has been greatly reduced because of that. So I'm sure you can see there how the filters work. Just a couple of other specific points about them though. Sometimes when you seem to only have a subset, so for instance here we've only got four of the departments shown, it doesn't necessarily mean that a filter has been applied. In this case, for example, the reason we've only got four departments is because of filters elsewhere. When a filter has been applied, such as in the case of date, to clear the filter there is always a clear filter from option. So if I say clear filter from date, then of course I get all of my departments back. And the other important thing to note is that where you have a date field of some kind, the date filters are pretty sophisticated, as in the rest of Excel. So you have date filters like next week, or last year, or next quarter, and so on. And these are very often the sorts of date filter that can help when you're doing analysis of transactional data. So having looked at a couple of ways of filtering, I want to look at one other way before we look at slicers. Let's look at the date filter again. What I'm going to do this time is to select one of the dates there, and then on the Analyze tab go back into Group, and I'm going to again say Group Field, and instead of just months I'm going to specify that I want quarters as well. Now of course what happens here, as you would expect, is that I finish up with rows that say branch, quarters and date. Now what I'm going to do is to drag quarters up into the filters drop zone. Watch what happens to the pivot table itself. The quarters column that I just introduced has gone again, because now quarters is being used as a filter on the whole table. And if I look up here, A1 is quarters, B1 currently all, if I click on the drop down I can see that I've got a filter I can use on quarters. So if all I want to do is to see, say, the quarter two sales figures, select quarter two, click on OK, and now my pivot table only includes the Q2 figures, which are basically April, May and June. So I can set up one or more of my data fields in the filters drop zone and use that as another way of filtering my pivot table. And maybe I should just mention one other thing very quickly, and that is that sometimes if a particular one of your data fields has a lot of values, so in this case we may have many, many departments for example, there is a search facility. So if I wanted to, say, filter on anything with the word T in it, for example, if I click on that filter, there's a search box there and I could type in T and I would find that there are actually two departments which have T in them, hot teas and T. Click on OK and I've filtered on all the departments with the word T in them. So finally in this section, let's take a look at slicers, which are a really good way of filtering a pivot table, partly because they're very flexible, partly because in terms of doing ad hoc analysis you can move them around on the screen and you can see several filters in force at once and build up really quite a sophisticated combination of filters and see very easily what you're doing. One of the disadvantages of the methods we've used so far is that even when you've got a filter in force on one or more of these little drop downs here, you can't generally see in the condition that this pivot table is in what those filters are set at. Now if you're going to use slicers, it's a good idea to have a bit of space around your pivot table on the left and above it as well. So to use slicers, the first thing you need to do is to make sure you've got a cell selected inside the pivot table. Then on the Analyze tab, click Insert Slicer. Now, you're given the option here of 5 slices because we've got 5 data fields. Well, we've got 4 data fields and the additional quarters that I've built up by grouping dates. Let's suppose that we're going to have slicer for branch and slicer for department at the moment. So let's just choose those two. Click on OK. And you see a department slicer and a branch slicer appear. Now the first thing to note about these is that you can move them around on the screen. So let me grab the department slicer and just move it, say, over to there, somewhere a little bit out of the way. And then I can grab the branch slicer and maybe put that over here on the left somewhere. Each of them is sizable, so if you want to make one a little bit narrower or a bit longer, then you can do all the normal things that you would expect to be able to do on a floating panel on a window. Now, when you've got a slicer selected, you actually have a Slicer Tools Options tab on the ribbon as well. And I'm not going to dwell on this too much, but I'm going to show you one or two of the basic things you can do. You can certainly change the size either by dragging or by using the controls here. But you can also change the number of columns in a slicer. So if we consider the department data field here, where we've got quite a few values, I could actually change this slicer to have more than one column. So let's suppose I wanted to be able to see all of that a bit better. I could change it to be in a 5-column slicer, and I could change its shape so that I can see more of the pivot table. Now obviously exactly what you do there will depend not only on the resolution of your screen and on what particular data fields you've got, but what particular analysis you want to do at any time. Now the basic use of the slicers is very straightforward. If you just want to select values of one of your variables, one of your data fields, then all you do is click it. So if all I want to see is juices, I click juices, and juices is all that's shown in my pivot table. To select more than one value for this data field, hold the control key down and select additional values. And then when I release the control key, I can see all of the values that I've selected. And it's straightforward to remove the filter that you've applied with the slicer at any time just by clicking on the clear filter button, top right hand corner of the slicer. You're back to a full selection again. Now it's worth experimenting with some of the options under the slicer tools here, including the slicer styles, where you've got a good gallery of alternative slicer styles, and you can even create your own if you want to. That can be particularly useful if you're doing some kind of presentation and you say want to match the pivot table and the slicers to some sort of corporate style, for example. And very briefly, just one other point on slicers. If you right click on the header of a slicer, you have a slicer settings dialog which you can use to determine whether you display a header, whether you're applying a sort order, and so on. So slicers are even more adaptable than they appear to be at first, really. And one very final thing to briefly demonstrate here, with a selection inside the pivot table again, on the Analyze tab, there is an Insert Timeline option. And this inserts what you might think of as a special sort of slicer. It's used only for fields of date type. And if you select the only date field we've got here, which is date, click on OK, you get a little date control here that you can use a bit like a slicer. But you can use it, for instance, to choose periods of time that you want to be covered within your report. So you can click on them, you can stretch this out, and so on. I'm going to leave you to experiment with filtering with a timeline. So that's it on pivot tables, filters, etc. A little bit later on in the course, we're going to come back and draw a pivot chart. But for now, we've finished on pivot tables. I'll see you in the next section. Thank you.